Hey friends, winters in Denmark are dark, long and very cold. If you have come to Northern Europe from a long way, as for example myself from South America, odds are that surviving the winter is one of the hardest things for you living here in Denmark. In today's video, I'll tell you not only how you then survive through the winter, but also how you thrive in the winter, and wait for it, even enjoy it. The way I have structured this video is that first, I'll tell you lifestyle choices you can make to then enjoy winter. Second, I'll tell you the gear you can get so you don't freeze when you go outside. Third, I'll tell you the specifics so you keep your sanity through especially this very dark period. When it comes to lifestyle, the first key is to embrace the cold. After all, the moment the calendar switches to October, it starts getting cold and it's not gonna get any better until potentially May or even June potentially. What you can do here is to, instead of being complaining and being suffering for this long period, just get at peace with winter, embrace winter, and try to thrive and make the most of the opportunity. You can start by embracing hygge. And hygge is this very specific Danish term which can be loosely translated into coziness. The Danes, and also the Scandinavians, let's give them some credit, are all about coziness. They're all about being hygglicked. The way you can live a hygglicked life starts at home, and at home you should have as many candles as possible. That's what all the Danes would tell you. And ideally, if the candles have a nice smell and if they're a little bit thicker and at the same time not so bright, meaning they are dim candles, the better. Have as many of these candles as possible. Have dim lights across the board, so make it sure that the candles get more of the attention if possible. Have wool blankets. For example, if you have a sofa, have multiple good blankets, a lot of pillows in bed as well. If you can, also buy wood furniture. If you have a good table, wooden floors, the more you make a house closer to nature, the better. And then it's all about spending time with your friends in also a cozy situation. So have friends over at your place, or go to their place, or go to a cafe, and there's nothing more cozy than just be in a sofa with candles all over the place, snuggled into a wool blanket while you're drinking your coffee or your tea, and chat about life and enjoying with your friends. And extra points if it's snowing outside and you can see the snow falling. That's something that it is very unique to Scandinavia. You don't really see it in a lot of other places. And here people just make the most of it and they want to really enjoy it. If you still don't get me here, just talk with your Danish friends, Danish colleagues, Danish people at school and so on. They will know exactly what hygglicked means and they will give you specific points and specific candle brands and so on you should get to make the most of it as well. It's something that the Danes will be incredibly passionate about and they will be incredibly happy to share with you. As an addendum to this hygglicked culture, embrace the Christmas spirit. And Christmas, on the Christmas period, in Northern Europe, it's beautiful. You have all the Christmas markets in the big cities, or even in the smaller cities as well, where you can go and, for example, drink the mulled wine while at the same time walking through like incredibly hygglicked decorations. It's just beautiful. And for example, you can also go to Tivoli, which is not only for kids, but it's something that, for example, I do myself every year. There's a lot of these uniquely Christmassy activities that are, again, not only just for children. It's something that makes us go out of the house and embrace, again, the winter and be outside and enjoy this unique time of the year. This is especially dear to my heart because I am from South America, and for us in the Southern Hemisphere, Christmas is in summer. So the fact that I can actually see the real Christmas period here, the, how it's supposed to be in the movies and how it was supposed to be originally, right? And kudos if we even have snow. That's incredible experience for me. So even though November might not be the best month and January can also be pretty cold and so on, December is just one month where I'm incredibly happy to be in Denmark or in Northern Europe. And if you're not a Christian, just keep an open mind in the sense that Christmas used to be a pagan, meaning pre-Christian holiday. It's something that is very unique to the north of Europe as well, in the sense that it's the shortest days of the year. It's not just about the birth of Jesus. Of course, that's important now, but historically, this was about the shortest days of the year have come, and now the days of the year will get longer. It's something that we are sitting down to celebrate and being cozy and being together as a family to say, okay, the worst is over, now it's gonna get better. Last on hygglicked and Christmas is that in Denmark, you have a big tradition of the Christmas party, what they also call the julefrokost. And this is the time of the year where basically every single weekend for the Danes from mid-November till potentially mid-January are fully booked, so you can actually go and meet with your friends and you have a cozy dinner while at the same time you drink a lot, especially something called snaps with the Danes love. My suggestion to you, if you're new in Denmark or if you're an expat in Denmark, try to go to as many of these Christmas parties as possible. Not only is it fun, but it's also one of the opportunities again to embrace something that it's unique to the culture of Northern Europe. Yes, we have Christmas parties, for example, where I come from as well, but there's nothing like the Christmas parties that you actually see in here because people really embrace that. Next up, you can go winter bathing. And this is a uniquely Scandinavian or Northern European activity, or only you can, something you can only do in places that are pretty cold in winter. And what it means in practice is that you jump into the sea or into a lake or into the canal in Copenhagen in winter, so in January, in February, and so on, when it's pretty cold in the water. Before you write me off, remember I am Latino, I'm not a guy who has been made, like genetically you name it, to just jump into the ice cold water in winter. So I have not even been jumping to the water in summer for my first, what, 5 or 6 years in Denmark at all, so completely the opposite now. I look forward for winter, for the time winter is coming, and for the, when the sauna wagons are out and I can actually go to just jump into the water and then go into the sauna. So it's again one of the things that you can only do here, and I see friends that they actually want to come here and visit in winter just because of this. Personally, when it comes to winter bathing, I like the social part of it, so I like going with my friends, that we go to the sauna all together and then we just jump into the water and make fun of each other whilst we are like moving ourselves in the cold, ice cold water and then back into the sauna. I think it's one of these nice bonding opportunities, and it's also pretty quick, as I said before, to be in the sauna and like then after the sauna sessions be all warmed up and be drinking tea in the tea house close to the place you were swimming outside. There are also specific health benefits to doing winter swimming, so it has been proven to strengthen your immune response, to make you have faster blood circulation, among other things. And icy deep also increases your level of adrenaline, serotonin, and dopamine, which means that you can also have a winter swim that makes you feeling warm and fuzzy. Just be aware of that. There's still some contraindications for winter swimming, so make sure you check with your doctor before you go ahead and do this for the first time. Last on this is that you can pretty much everywhere go winter swimming in Denmark. In myself, for example, I go to the Islandsbrugge Winter Bathing Club, which is just a few minutes away walking from my house. But if you don't have any fancy club where you can go to, you can still go and swim in a lake or in the sea and so on. Maybe you wouldn't have a sauna facility or something like that, but nothing stops you from doing it anyway. I have a lot of friends who just do this without going to sauna after. You can just drink a warm tea and cozy up after. Last on lifestyle is to go skiing. And skiing is great. It's one of the things that a lot of people look really forward to doing in winter. And it's something that maybe you can't do very much in Denmark. Well, yes, you have this power plant where you can go skiing, but let's be honest, most people go to Sweden, they go to Norway, or also if you're a bit fancier, you go to the Alps. And skiing is great. I personally love skiing. I also did snowboarding in the past. I love it as well. Talking about Huglicht, there's almost very few things in the world that are as Huglicht as being in one of those ski inns in the mountains where you can go with your friends. And after a good round of skiing, you can just be drinking your hot chocolate or whatever you want. That's super nice, and again, it's one of those things that for a lot of people make them to look forward to being in winter. If skiing is not your thing, or even if skiing is your thing, on top of that you can also go sledging, and that's something you can also do in the city. So for example, my son is absolutely crazy about sledging. He loves it. So the moment he sees snow, he's asking for kelk, which means sledge in Danish, and then we go to the park and we go through the kind of forest in the park in Amman. He absolutely loves it. He like has the time of his life with sledging, and this is something that, of course, mostly for kids, but even as an adult, it's a lot of fun to just put your winter gear on and more of that later in the video, and then just embrace that and go and really enjoy it with your son as well. Now, if you don't like skiing or you don't want to go skiing, and also you don't have children to go sledging with, one of the best activities you could do in winter in Northern Europe is to go and see the Northern Lights in the top of Northern Europe. So Northern Lights in Denmark, very hard to see, it's possible, but at least I have not really heard from any friends yet. But a lot of friends, they do travel to the north of Sweden, north of Finland, north of Norway, or to Iceland. And then yes, you can see the Northern Lights. And it's one of these, if you are already in the north of the north, you know, if you're already in this part of the world, for example, go and check that out. It's one of those very uniquely winterly wonderland experiences. I went, for example, to the north of Finland, to a place called Lapland, and there, one of the nights I was there with a friend, we could see the green lights moving in the sky. It was absolutely fantastic. It's how uniquely, I mean, it was cold as hell, but it was absolutely incredible experience, and I recommend that to everyone. And when you go to these places, for example, when we were in Lapland, you could do a lot of also other wintry activities. Of course, you could go cross-country skiing if that's your thing, but we went like sledging with the huskies, then we went driving snowmobiles in the forest, we go on to see these polar bear reserves, and even like in the north of Finland, you also had this Santa's workshop, so you could actually go and looks like that legit Santa workshop. So there's a lot of really interesting and exciting things you could do in up there in the very far north, and again, you can only do it when it's really cold in winter. Now moving on to gear, and you can't really enjoy the winter without being properly protected. And there's a saying in Scandinavia that says, there's not really cold weather, they're just not good clothes. What I'll do now is that I'll share my specific recommendations on what is the gear you should get in order to be hours on end outside, for example at a Christmas market or sledging and so on, without feeling cold. Just keep in mind as well is that I spend a lot of time outside, I don't have a car, and I almost exclusively bike out in the snowstorms and so on. So maybe what I find for interesting for myself might be overkill for some other people, but at least this is what has been working for me. First, get the best jacket possible. There's nothing that you'll use as much in winter as your jacket. It's something that you likely will be using for 5 or 6 months of the whole year. So get the best jacket that you can. Specifically, my recommendation is that you should look for something that is insulated, meaning that it's really warm. Second, that is wind and waterproof, because it's gonna be raining a lot. And third, if you can, find something that's also stylish, because as I said, 5 or 6 months, even though if you're gonna be all snugged outside, try to get something that looks nice. My recommendation here, and I'm not an expert on outdoors, but this is what has been working for me and for the people that I'm closely related with, is to get a down insulated and Gore-Tex jacket. Down insulation means these feathers of horses and so on, which basically are very light, meaning it's not a thick, high, big jacket, but at the same time keeps you really warm. And on top of that, you want something Gore-Tex. Gore-Tex is this fabric that basically keeps you waterproof. The sky is falling, you don't get wet. It's amazing. And it is more expensive, but the fact is that you're gonna be raining a lot, there's gonna be snow and so on. You want something that you can just brush aside and like 2 minutes later be completely dry. My recommendation when it comes to jackets is to go with Arc'teryx. Arc'teryx is a Canadian brand that makes very warm, rainproof and also stylish jackets, and they're made for the Canadian winter, which is probably a lot worse than we have here in Northern Europe. These jackets are so warm that you just completely forget that it's so cold outside. So I can be with this t-shirt, a scarf and like gloves and so on, and it's minus 10 outside and I'm not cold. I don't even need to put a sweater on. So it's that level of warmness that you get from this jacket, which, because of the down insulation and so on, you can use the same jacket when it's 10 degrees and when it's minus 10, and at the same time don't feel so much difference because it's so well made. Now, these jackets are, as you might expect, expensive. So you will not really find an Arc'teryx jacket for less than 4,000 krona, and the good ones go for considerably more than that. Keep in mind, yeah, it's a big expense, but at the same time, you're gonna be using this a lot. One of the things, for example, that I like myself about Arc'teryx versus other brands is that they also have a lifetime guarantee. So after 3 years, because I have been using that jacket for that long, 3 years, something broke with the zipper, I packed my jacket, sent it to Arc'teryx, they sent me the same jacket back with the zipper fixed. So they have that level of service again, because they expect you that when you buy something from them, you lose it for many, many years. If this sounds to you like a lot of money and you might need to be saving up, make sure you check this video that I link over here where I explain the best ways to save money in Denmark. If you get a proper jacket, you are like 70% of the way to getting warm in winter. But on top of that, my suggestions are, get rain pants. It's gonna be raining a lot through autumn and winter, and especially if you're biking, you want something to put on top of your jeans or normal pants that you use in the day-to-day. When you get somewhere, you just take the pants off and you don't get wet. Of course, if you're a very cold person, you can get also these down-insulated Gore-Tex pants that are better than any cheap rain pants. I just bought any cheap rain pants, but I'm not as cold on my legs as I'm on my chest, for example, but no, that goes from person to person. And then combine a bit of wool with a bit of Gore-Tex. So when it comes to socks, any wool merino socks, they're normally really good. Very thick merino socks that keeps your feet warm in the worst case scenarios. Same if you have a hat, that is also these wool hats. They also keep your head and your ears pretty warm. Beyond that, when it comes to Gore-Tex, get gloves that are also warm, but at the same time rainproof, because you are likely gonna get wet. And same with your shoes. So my suggestion for winter is that you should have also Gore-Tex shoes or something that can be rain and snowproof, because you're gonna get your feet wet. In my case, I have like normal sneakers that are Gore-Tex, and then also have like some hardcore boots that I use when it's really bad or when I need to go sledging into the forest. Last on gear, and if it's only if you can splurge, get floor heating for your house. Believe me, it's amazing. So here in Denmark, you really need a lot of heating in winter. It gets pretty cold, so you want a house that is very well insulated, and on top of that, has good heating. Most houses, especially the old houses, they have radiators. The radiators, they take a lot of space, they kind of add a lot of clutter, and they also, because the like heat comes straight up, you can actually get your house pretty dry. If you have floor heating, it doesn't have any clutter, you don't really see it, and at the same time keeps your house warmer across the board instead of having all the heat concentrated in one or two places. This is absolute splurge. It was, for example, when looking for a house, this was one critical criteria for me. I wanted like floor heating because I just wanted to splurge on that. Not that you need to as well, but just know that these opportunities are there, and it just makes it easier to go through the winter at home. Third section, how to keep sane in winter. And the first one is to keep going out. So you need to be out of your house as much as you can, even now in winter. Of course, you'll be inside doing the hygienic activities, but at the same time, you should be still spending time out. And as I said before, there's no bad weather, there's just bad clothes. And if you have the right gear, you can be out for hours on end without feeling cold. My suggestion is that go out with your friends to Tivoli, go out with your partner to walk in the city, go out with your children if you have children to sledge in the park, and do that for hours on end. And one of the positive things you could say that came out of all the COVID situation was that as a lot of people just couldn't meet indoors before, they would just go and meet outside. And even though it was cold, people were prepared, which has they had their cup of hot tea in the hand and so on. And just know that if you're gonna be waiting waiting for the days to become a bit longer or for the sunshine to be a bit warmer and so on, you're gonna be waiting for a long time. So it's better to just embrace it and just be outside the way it is. On a similar note to this, don't stop working out outside. So if, for example, if you have a tradition that you like running outside in summer or in spring or in autumn, keep doing that in winter. You just need to be a bit more clothed up. You might not be able to do it for as long, but it will still be good for you to do this outside. So there's a lot of benefits, health benefits, on doing cardio, raising your heart rate up and so on, but also of doing that, for example, if you do it in nature, in the parks. There may be less leaves on the trees and so on, but you will still have a good experience by doing this outdoors versus doing it in a gym indoors. So again, just be more prepared and keep doing that. Maybe if you have been running 3 times a week, you might run once a week or twice a week, but the fact that you still do that is going to be good for your mental health and for your spirit, and will help you again push through the winter period. Next, take vitamin D. I strongly suggest for most people that you supplement with vitamin D during the darkest months. So specifically, I take vitamin D between October and February. These are the times that it's super dark, you don't get a lot of sunshine, and for those of you who don't know, you only get vitamin D when you get direct sunlight exposure. So if you're not in the sun, and for example, my first winter in Denmark, I saw the sun once in the whole of December. The way you go through this and the way you keep your body healthy and so on is by getting this as a supplement. Now, how much you should get as a supplement and how often and what should be the dosage and so on, this is something you should align with your doctor. My recommendation is that, you likely should take, for most people, vitamin D, but before you go ahead and self-medicate, check in with your doctor, either by email or a call and so on, but clarify with them what, based on your own profile, you should be taking. If you are more adventurous, and I've shared this in other videos as well, you can also eat more fish during winter as well. Fish is supposed to be very good as well. So what I do myself is that I open a can of sardines, which also has some vitamins and B12 and so on, and eat that for breakfast. Not every day, but some other times, and of course I brush my teeth after that. But this actually helps, and I can see that I lift my energy and lift my mood. I don't know if it's a placebo or it's a real deal, but from what I can understand, it actually helps. So eat more fish as well. Last but not least, travel somewhere warm, and if possible, somewhere sunny. So guys, I have something to confess. I have been now spending quite a few minutes telling you about how to embrace this winter, how to be at peace with winter, how to be in thriving in the darkness. But the reality is that every single year I have been in Denmark, so now for over 10 years, except last year because of COVID, I have been spending at least a few weeks, normally between 2 to 3 or sometimes 4 or 5 weeks outside of Denmark during the winter period. Now, you might be thinking, this guy is crazy. He just basically told us to be at peace with winter, and like he does tells us to go and travel. But the reality is that in my lifestyle for the last many years, I have been traveling a lot. I have been out of the country so many times because, you know, that's how you get to 135 countries visited, right? So if you're gonna be traveling a lot as I do, why not do it in the time that is not so nice in Denmark and just stay home when it's nice? So I'm almost not taking any holidays, or at least not holiday traveling, between what, like May and October, and bank all my holidays and all my travel plans and so on during this winter period. What I normally do, and what I did actually exactly this year as well, is that I travel quite a bit if I can in November. I think November is probably the worst month of winter because it's dark, it's cold, it's rainy, but at the same time there's not a lot of the Christmas spirit out there. I stay here for December because I like the Christmas spirit, and then when it comes to January, February, I go and travel again. I have travel plans, and if Omicron and all that allows, I'll also be traveling in during that period as well. These travels give me a boost of sunshine, a boost of good mood, a little bit of a tan if I can, and then with that I can come back again to the Danish winter and not be like just thinking like, okay, wow, it's gonna be a long time. These little trips may give me something to look forward to enjoy again, even if it's only for 4 or 5 days. See some sunshine, get a bit of a boost up, and then come back to Denmark and use the productivity opportunities of winter and the hug and so on to the best of their abilities. Next up, if you want to make the most of your life in Denmark also beyond winter, you should check this video over here where I explain my favorite things about living in Denmark. With that, leave in the comments any thoughts that you have or any other strategies you might think are cool to use to cope through winter. I'll be really excited to hear about that. Thank you for watching, and see you next week.